bubbly. So kind of messy and also dissimilar. Today we have Sebastien, and he's going to give us an exploratory talk on gaps and lines.
So this main gap terminology is hard to grasp, I guess. So the goal of this talk would be to give an explanation of it. So this is all, I mean, the hard results in this talk are all due to Saharon Shelah and appeared in a book of his that appeared in 1990. But he did the work before the 1980s. So what we want to do is look at certain classes of structures and understand them, or say why we cannot understand them. So I would have to stay a little bit vague about what I mean by classes of structures, at least at the beginning of the talk. But by structure, I mean things, algebraic things like groups, certain classes of groups, fields, vector spaces, modules, you name it. Also more combinatorial objects like linear orderings. So we'll discuss all of these structures, and I'll give, toward the end of the talk, I'll give kind of a more rigorous definition of what kind of structures we're looking at. So what do we want to know about this class of structures? We want to know when we can understand them and when we cannot. So I'm sure most of you have seen at least one structure theorem in your undergraduate classes. So let me give you two examples. So structure theorems are results that tell you basically the class can be understood. Every object can be decomposed into simple objects or even assigned dimensions. So one well-known example is the classification of finite abelian groups, or even finitely generated abelian groups. So an abelian group is one where multiplication is commutative, and it's finitely generated if there is a finite set from which you can get all the other elements. So all the other elements are products of this finite set. Or you can just think of finite abelian groups first. And so the structure theorem here says every finitely generated abelian group, G, is isomorphic to a product of z to the power n 0, and then some cyclic groups. So z to the power n 1, cp 1. So this is the cyclic group with p1 elements, so your usual arithmetic modulo p1. Take n1 copies of it. And you have this for a couple of problems. So this gives you a very simple decomposition of each such group. You know, it's not obvious, but you can prove that. Even more well-known example is vector spaces. So if you look at a vector space, every vector space V over some field F, so like fields or complex numbers, it has one dimension, and the dimension determines everything. So you can just take lambda many copies of F for lambda cardinal. So if you think of F as being real, for example, every vector space, you know, could be zero dimensional, so point, one dimensional, so line, two dimensional, and so on, and then you can go into the infinite. So you could have countably many, an infinite countability of dimension, and even more dimensions than that. But in any case, you need only one cardinal lambda, right? So in those two examples, we have kind of dimensions implicitly entering the picture. So here, every vector space has one dimension, this lambda, and this dimension just tells you everything you need to know about the vector space. And here, it has, well, you need more than that. You need like a finite sequence of integers, those n0, n1, n2, nm, and also those p1, p2, and pn. But you need, you know, a small sequence of cardinals that determines the object. So in both cases, objects are determined by dimensions. And I won't make precise what the dimension is, though I will outline some problem with the obvious attempt to by dimension. So in the first case, it's just lambda. In the second case, it's just lambda. In the first, well, I mean, there are many ways to say it, but really, you just need to specify n0, n1, n1, n2, b2, and so on. So the question I would like to discuss, and it's a very general question, like you might say hopelessly general, but actually it's not so hopeless because you can say something in a very general framework, is, okay, given your favorite class of objects, can you assign, you know, a dimension function like this? Can you understand it completely with the decomposition theorem? Or can you prove that it's impossible? So even K, a class of structures, when can we understand it as a dot? I.e., determine every member by dimension. And I don't only mean, you know, when can we do it, but also when we cannot do it. So it's kind of the interesting point of the result I will discuss. You can say some things for both sides. So if, you know, you can give a criteria for when it is well behaved, in that case you can prove the dimension theorem. But if the criteria is not satisfied, you can also prove that it's impossible. It's not just saying, oh, if my class is a class of finitely generated abelian groups, then I can say something. Because, well, if your class is not this thing, maybe you can also say something. Yeah. There are many other examples. So it's not just, it's not as simple as saying, you know, giving an easy criteria. So, what exactly do I mean by dimension? Well, the minimum requirement is that it will determine the model up to isomorphism. So it is a function dim in the domain K such that, you know, if you take two elements K and N, so two groups or two vector spaces, then they are isomorphic if and only if they have the same dimension. But this criteria is not really enough, because if you just have this criteria, then you could just take the dimension of M, just define it to be the equivalence class of M under the equivalence relation being isomorphic to. So, you know, it's not as simple as that. You have to restrict yourself to simple objects. And you could say, well, dimension is a single cardinal, but this example doesn't really fit into the pictures. And there are other examples. For example, if you look at algebraically closed fields, you need a characteristic plus another dimension. So you need two things. And in general, you need a small number of things, but sometimes it's not just a small sequence. So it's a somewhat thorny issue. So I would just say, intuitively, it should be some small So I don't want to exactly explain what the dimension should be or would be, but there is a way to see what the dimension would do. If you have a nice notion of dimension, what it would do to your class. Something you observe here is that it kind of restricts the number of models. So if you have only one dimension, you have very few objects because you know there are very few possible dimensions, and so you know, you cannot have too many objects. So for example, what's the effect of having a structure in here? And those are all, you know, it's a big discussion. I'm not making any of these precise, but trying to give you intuition for why the results I will skip next is interesting and related to that question. So if you have a nice dimension function, whatever that is, what would you expect? Well, for example, in the case of vector spaces, there are very few models. If there were too many, you wouldn't be able to just reduce them to a small sequence of cardinals. So there should be few non-isomorphic models. So if you can prove that there are many, many models, then you know the contrapositive of this will tell you that there cannot be any dimensional function. So if IK lambda is big, that cannot be a structure. It cannot be. And depending on what you get, you can either deduce that you have some dimension or you don't have anything. So let's look at an example. What is this weird IK lambda function on vector? Yes.
I'm just wondering, what's the precise definition of size if we don't have a notion of dimension?
Yeah, so, okay, so size, what's the size? Well, it's cardinality, right? So, so, you know, I haven't done this review, I guess maybe it's good to do it now. You can define notion of sizes on sets and also on infinite sets. So you can say sets X and Y have the same size or cardinality if there is a bijection between them. You can sort of show that those sizes are linearly ordered, actually nice linearly ordered, so cardinals are intuitively different classes of this relation. For this relation of having the same size. So when I say some object has size lambda, I mean look at this universe, which will have some bijection with this cardinal lambda. So you know what's the size of numbers. Well, you can show that it's the same as the size of the integer, which is the same as the size of rational numbers. So they're all in bijection, and this size is called an F-naught. It's the first infinite cardinal. And then you can look at the sizes of the reals, for example, and you can show it's bigger than an F-naught, and it's called the F-naught. It's the same as the size of the power set of the numbers. There is a theory of sizes of infinite objects. So not all infinite objects have the same size, but still there is like this nice linear ordering on sizes. So I don't know if this answers your questions. This is what I mean when I say some object has size lambda. Lambda is some infinite number. Could be finite too, actually, but mostly I'm interested in infinite objects. Yeah, this is what it says to be by the size. We just look at this universe and count it. So let me give you an example. Maybe it will be clearer.
So here you just say on the last page the everything that has the same cardinality in the structure. Then you examine how many are.
So yeah, I want to just look at structures of the same fixed cardinality lambda. So I'm fixing lambda, and I want to say, oh, how many objects of this particular size are there?
Okay.
So let me give an example.
Well, so that lambda is not the same as that.
This lambda here?
Might not be,
but in that, actually, it will be the same. So let me just, so for vector spaces, so let's of vector spaces over Q. So F is Q here. And let's look at IK, let's look at IKN for finite N first. So lambda is N. So I want to know how many vector spaces over the rationals are there that have only n many vectors. So, well, if n is different than 1, there's none, right? So, okay, so it's 0, n is not 1. I know there's the 0 vector space. So we can look at finite objects, but in that case, it's not really interesting. So, you know, this one is q to the power 0. So, certainly that. So you're right, so this lambda is not the same thing. Okay, so more interesting is what happens when you look at countable sizes. So how many vector spaces for the rationals have the same size as the rationals, the natural numbers? So let's try to list them. I mean, I've told you that they all have this form, and we started with the q to the power 0 here. So we can list them. So there is q to the power 1, which has the same size as q. Then you have q to the power 2, which, you know, is just a bunch of pairs, each of which is a rational number. And you can show, actually, that, so it's also a fact that I will use, I guess. Infinite sizes behave very well in terms when you add them and when you multiply them. So if you take two infinite numbers and you add them and multiply them, you just get the max. So addition and multiplication are the same. And give that. So here, the size of q squared is the same as the size of q cross q, same as the size of q times the size of q, which is just alf naught times alf naught. so still count what you made. So you have at least two of them. But there's no reason to stop here. I mean, you have Q3 and so on. And you even have Q to the power of what? So I guess it's slightly.
You mean like Q less than omega?
Yeah. Taking that itself, so yeah, so it's slightly tricky issue, but this, you know, you take direct sum, so every vector is just finite.
So yeah,
so really it's kind of this. Yeah. So the point is, you know, you can just count them. And everyone has countable size. So in the end, you just get added not many. We have 1, 2, 3, and so on, and then this one. Okay. So this is for the countable case. Now what about the uncountable case? So in that case, you can show it has only one. Which is this Q to the lambda. So, I don't know, it's slightly confusing notation. But what it says is that the basis has size lambda. So, and you know, every vector is a finite combination of things in the basis. So it's basically lambda to the power finite, which is just lambda. The size it is. So last time, in a previous talk, I showed you know, very precisely why this was true. But yeah, basically the idea is the size of Q to the power lambda is just lambda. So then you just, using this this result, you get this only one. This is what the it's called the spectrum function. This is what it looks like. So we see that it's very small, like it's one eventually. So this makes some sense because we've seen that there is some dimension. So dimension should reduce the number of models.
Yeah, that was great.
Does it make any sense?
Go ahead, please.
Example on the other side. So I've given you many nice examples. What to I've given you vector spaces and abelian groups. So let me give you an example where this spectrum function is not well behaved. So, oh, okay, maybe before I do this, let me just say if you look at abelian groups, finitely generated abelian groups. There are only countably many of them, just because they are finitely generated. So you take some finite set, then each one is kind of a product of this finite set. So it's, you can show there are only countably many of them. So again, you're just restricting the number very much. Okay. So let's look at K at the class of dense linear orders. Between any two points, there is another point. So for every a less than b, there is c with a less than c. And it doesn't have endpoints, so it has no maximum and no minimum. So the two examples that are easy to give are the rationals and the reals. Between any two rationals, you have a rational. Reals at the same time. So let's look at this function there. So first of all, what about finite? Yellows. So then so how many are there? Of size 2. You know what I mean, right? Because if there were only two elements, you could find one in between, so there would be three. So for the same reason, there cannot be any five elements. Okay, and now I will state two results and I will prove them. I'm going to sketch the proof. For countable ones, well, I gave you one example, it's the rationals, and there's only one. Up to isomorphism, of course, you can rename the rationals, but you always get the bijection and preserve the order. But, and that's the interesting part, when lambda is uncountable, you have 2 to the power lambda, which by definition is just the size of the power set of lambda. And you can show it's always bigger than lambda. You can also show, actually, that this is the maximum number of possible models. So, always, you will have that the number of models of size lambda is bounded by 2 to the power.
If your language is like smaller than lambda or something.
Yeah, I guess so. So it's, I don't want to deal with this. Subset of a universe of size lambda, and the best you can hope for is that you cannot put them in bijection and preserve the structure. So you can always show that. So this is the maximum number you can expect. So this result tells you in a strong sense that there cannot be any reasonable dimension for linear orders. Doesn't mean you cannot understand them in some other ways, but in this very strong dimension kind of sense, it's going to be very, it's going to be impossible. However, you should note that here there is only one countable model, but there were LF not many. So that's why I wrote somewhere that you wanted to just look at the asymptotic behavior. Like in countable things and finite things, it's just, you know, incidental. You don't really know what's going on. You just get some noise. Not exactly noise, but you get something that's not too relevant. So really you want to focus on what happens eventually. So any questions on this statement? Proof, I will prove that. So let's see why. So let's look first at the second one. So I will show something weaker. It's not that easy to prove, actually. So I will just show the idea for something weaker. I will show that it's hard to deal with countable sizes in general, so I'll just look at 2 to the LF naught, so the size of the reals. And we'll just show it's much bigger than 1. So I'll give some idea on how to build many models. You know, I'll build at least 2. Okay, so what's one example? I just wrote one here, it's the reals. So now I want to build one that is not isomorphic to the reals. So we'll just look at a property of the reals that holds and try to kind of falsify it. So in the reals, just as an ordering, you look at 2 points, there are uncountably many points in between. In R, every interval, every open interval, has uncountably many points. Between 0 and 1, you can show that this has the same size as the real, so it's uncountable. So now let's try to build. Let's try to build something that doesn't have this property. And when I know some linear order that doesn't have this property, it's the rational, because it's countable. So I can just happen the rational to these reals and see what happens. If I look at the reals concatenated with the rationals, so this means take the ordering on the reals and then add a copy of the rationals and make sure that every rational is above the reals, so it's a disjoint copy. But then, there you have two points, and the number of points between them is countable. So this cannot be isomorphic to this. So the Q, the R, there is an open interval with countable points. So the bottom line is that R cannot be isomorphic to R. And you know, the size of this is 2 to the LF naught plus LF naught. And I just take the max, but it's just 2 to the LF naught. So I've just built two different ones. How would I build a third one? Well, I can vary, you know, give a variation on this construction. What about Q concatenated with R concatenated with Q? Well, you can show that, you know, it cannot be isomorphic to the real for the same reason. It cannot be isomorphic to this one because there the weakness is before this copy of R and the other after. So also this one is another isomorphic model, I just need three. And in general, you know, I can look at, you know, all possible sequences of those R and Q concatenated in various ways and prove that there are 2 to the lambda many that are non-isomorphic. So this is the part where I'm a bit sketchy about it. It's not that easy to do actually, but it can be done.
Like, you can make 2 to the lambda many just of this form of like R's and Q's and
you have to code stationary sets.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not a an easy argument. It's, I'm sweeping something under the rug, it's a big so anyway, there are at least 3 non-isomorphic models. I can build countably many if I want. Yeah, I mean, this number 2 to the lambda is very big. If you take lambda to be the reals, this means you have to build as many structures as the number of functions from the reals to the reals. So, you know, this is, those are all non-trivial facts. This is the idea. So what happens at the countable stage? Why cannot I do this? So let's see. This is actually due to Cantor. This is this result here is much easier. So I can give a more complete proof. So I want to show there is only one. I know there is at least one, the rational. So I will just take 2 of them. That's Q1 is less than 1 and Q2 less than 2. Assuming they are countable. And I want to show that they are isomorphic. And I will use something called the back and forth method. So I want to build an isomorphism. So it's a bijection that preserves order. And I will do it by taking an element here, mapping it somewhere there, and then taking an element here, mapping it there, and continuing in this way. So let's see. I take an element A from here. I want to map it there. Well, it's a density order. It looks the same everywhere since it's countable. So I just map it anywhere. I just pick some points, B0, and I map it there. OK, now I will switch my focus. I will start here. I will pick point 1 that has not been covered yet. And I know that this order has no maximum element. So I can just send it somewhere above B0. It doesn't matter. Then, again, I switch back, so let's take an element here, for example, between the two. And I know that this is a density ordering, so there's always a point in between the two, so I can just select one. Doesn't matter which. By now you should get the picture. I would pick a point here, here, or there, doesn't matter, let's say here, B3, and I can always find the point there that I can map it to. And I will continue. At every step, I have only finitely many things, which means I can always find a point that is relevant. And once I have done this iteration, I will have, you know, if I make sure I exhaust my domains, I have only counted many of them, so I can enumerate them, and at the end, I will have covered everything. So just continue counting your steps. And you know, you can ask, why does this fail when these things are uncountable? Well, you won't be able to exhaust everything after counting many steps. So once you have an infinity of things there, you no longer know that you can find a corresponding element on the other side. So there was this example I just gave. The reals have always uncountably many points between two things. So they are pretty wide, but the rationals only have countably many. So maybe you've exhausted this countable infinity on one side and not on the other, and you won't have to. This is what it is. So this shows that there is only one. There always is one conclusion. Okay, so I've given you two examples. One was vector spaces, which still has some remnants there. And vector spaces are the nice dimension function, they're very well behaved, and so their number of models is very small. Density in orders are an example where it's very impossible to have a nice dimension function because there are many models in every council code. So, what does the main gap say? Say that it's the only thing that can happen. Either you have very few models and you have a nice dimension, or you have many and it's impossible to have a nice dimension. And that's, of course, not for all classes, strictly speaking, so let me write down the statement and then explain what classes occur. So this is Shelah's name. So if K is appropriate, so K is the class axiomatized countably many first order axioms. And I will explain what that is. Then, you have two possibilities. Either IK
completion has a nice dimension.
It's a technical thing. So this works, but I guess you can reduce yourself. Okay, so maybe I'll state a fun, interesting corollary of this. So that was done later by Laskowski. Actually, you can compute this function exactly. You can say what it is. You can give all the possible functions. Moreover, I can lambda for lambda countable is one of 12 possible families of functions. You don't ask me why 12, but you can analyze everything and know everything about it. And for each one, you can give yourself. that's kind of an interesting corollary of this. Since you know exactly what those functions are, you can prove that this function is actually monotonic. So ik lambda is less than equal to ik mu when if not is less than lambda is less than.
There's not an easier proof of that.
No, this is the funny thing that, you know, you might think, you know, it's easy because you just have some number of models and some small kernel lambda, you just expand them and you get more, gain more above. But, you know, it's not that easy to formulate this proof, and it doesn't work. I mean, if it worked, you wouldn't get the countable examples at countable sizes, right? I've given you an example of vector spaces that has countably modular structures at countable levels, but then has only one, so you kind of collapse. This is called Morley's spectrum conjecture. So this was conjecture. So it's not a conjecture anymore.
No, but how recently?
I think 1960s.
Okay.
That was proved, those kinds of things were talking about this in like the...
No, no, so what was the question? When was it proven?
Yeah.
Oh, the 1990s.
Also. Okay.
This was conjecture in 1960s.
Yeah.
And you know, and you might think, you know, what is, you know, we have this ridiculously obscure function, I've just managed to compute it, what's the point? Actually, you can, you know, all the machinery that you develop doing that, there's actually many other applications to algebra, and combinatorial set theory, number theory, and all these things. So there are, for example, those things for the Morden Lang conjecture and number theory that have been, lots of lights have been shed on them, these methods. So these are kind of, you know, test problems or, yeah, test problems that shed light on many other problems just by the machinery that you developed. Okay, so in the rest of this talk, I will tell you a little bit about how you prove these things. Because, you know, I haven't told you anything about the proof, I've just given you examples and then the statement, but it's not obvious why this should be true.
Yes, we can change top line to slow growth.
Oh, yeah. Sure. Maybe I will say what I mean by the nice structure theorem, because it's easier to state. And then I will write the slow growth matrix. So, what is this? It tells you if you have a model K. So, remember the structure theorem for abelian groups. Write everything as a product. Well, here you're not going to be able to write everything as a product, but you can write everything as a kind of tree of things. So I will draw a picture. You have a tree, a bunch of model, zero, one, and two. You know, there could be many things there. Then M, zero, one, and so on. Branches, you can branch many times. But all those models are kind of free from each other, they don't interact, it's like a product. And this has finite size. Every branch is finite. And M is, you know, minimal over this thing, so it's generated by this nice tree. And all those models are small. So size of M beta is bounded by. You can decompose every model as a kind of nice tree. A nice, yeah, so it's, the picture maybe doesn't convey it very well, but every model can be decomposed into a nice tree or product of things.
So the width and the height are...
So the height are finite and the width is, well, it's the size of them. The width is not. So already by this analysis, we kind of bound the cardinal function because, you know, there can be at most 2^2 to the LF0 many models of this size. And then since the tree is so nice, decomposition will be more or less unique, and so you can bound the number of models in this cardinal just by counting the number of trees. And concretely, what does this slow growing mean? I'll just write it. You would think that it's not slow growing at all because there will be lots of exponentials in this statement. Okay, this is strictly less than bad aleph 1 of some pi k aleph alpha is strictly less than this. Okay, where this bad sub aleph 1 means a tower. Aleph 1 many 2 to the 2 to the so on things. And aleph alpha is the alpha cardinal. So, why the hell is it still growing if you have so many exponentials? Well, here I'm taking the alpha cardinal, so this could be much bigger than alpha. And I'm only taking an exponential of it, of alpha, not aleph alpha. And this exponential is bounded by aleph 1. So this is, so I don't know, it doesn't really make much sense why it's slow growing. But you can show that for certain values of alpha, assuming reasonable set deviations, this potential is really less than 2. So asymptotically, it's less. Yeah, so if you assume the continuum hypothesis, this is fine.
I mean, do you need the continuum hypothesis for that?
You don't need it, but there are models where this thing is all.
Is equal?
Yeah.
Oh, so it can be equal to.
Yeah, we can talk about it after.
Okay.
So this is why I'm saying it's maybe more important to remember that there's a nice structure theorem than to remember the exact bound on the cardinal spectral function. So how do you prove this thing? So this is where the dividing line part of the title is going to come in. Oh, before that, I said I'm working somewhere that I raised it. I'm working in a countable first order set of axioms. What does it mean? What is a first order axiom? It's something like for every x there exists y x times y. So you allow quantification but only over elements. So this is why it's first. So you're not allowed to do something like for every s subset of reals or something like this. S has an upper bound. It's false, but you're not allowed to say it. You're not allowed to quantify over sets. You can only quantify over small elements. So you're allowed to have countably many things like this. So for example, groups, you can express all the axioms of groups in terms of distance. But you cannot express the axioms of Archimedean field, for example. So cannot express that for every x, there exists a natural number n such that x is less than 1 plus 1 plus 1 n times. So you can only quantify over elements in your thing, so this would be in your universe. But you cannot quantify over natural numbers. So you cannot write something like this. So the bottom line is for groups and linear orders and simple objects it will work, otherwise it will not work. So there are counterexamples, but still it encompasses a very wide variety of objects. And you only allow countably many. If it's, you could ask what about uncountably many axioms, then it's not. consider. So it's so you have many possible classes. For each class, I want to prove something. So this is the set of all classes structure that are first order axiomatizable in this sense. And I will look at a dividing line. I will look at a property for which I can say something on both sides. So I can say something if the property fails, if the class is bad, and I can say something if the class is good. So the trick is to find such properties. But here is one. It's called being stable. So this has some definition, I will give it. The bottom line is you can show if the class is stable, it's pretty nice, you can analyze it further. If it's not stable, you directly have a method to compute the number of models and you get the maximum number of models. So if you're not stable, you cannot have any hope of doing anything with it. Okay. But if K is stable, you can repeat this step. So you have all the stable classes here. And now, well, maybe it's not possible to do something with all of them. But you can know something more and invent another dividing line to continue the analysis. This is going to be called super stable. So again, if it's not super stable, even if it's still stable, and the fact that it's stable will give you extra information that will allow you to do your proof, then you have maximum number of points. If it's super stable, it's again much better behavior than before. You can continue. And you can find more dividing lines until you've exhausted everything. So actually, five of them are needed. So there is top, top, deep. I don't know what these are exactly.
What should I make?
What?
Are they abbreviations or are they just words?
Yeah, they are abbreviations. Okay. This is omitting type order property. This is dimensional order property. This is just yeah, there's deep and okay. The opposite is shallow. So if you don't have the top, then if you're on the bad side of these things, you get many models. If you're on the good side of all these things, then it's so nice that you can just count everything and you have a nice decomposition too, and everything works. This is the idea. And I will just explain what stable is and won't say anything about the other properties. But this is, I think, a very nice philosophical conceptual approach. It's not often the case in mathematics that you do that. Like, for example, if you look at abelian groups, well, the property of being abelian, abelian groups are very nice, things commute, but even if you're not abelian, you can say a lot about the group. It's not obvious that there's this non-structured thing that it's impossible to do anything with it. This is the difference between dividing lines and regular property that models. That's right. Of course, it's harder to find them, but even finding them is an interesting question in itself. Let me say a few words about stable, then I will stop. So essentially, what those dividing lines say is that the class has some kind of nice object that can be defined into it. So stable will say that, well, unstable, so the bad side of stable will say that there is an ordering in it. There is a density ordering inside, and this will allow us to kind of imitate the proof that there are many models in density orders. And if there is no ordering, you know a lot about the class already, you can kind of continue your analysis. So not super stable, we say there is a tree, a weird tree that can be defined. So it's not quite an ordering, it's a tree. But if there is no tree, then you can continue further. So let me define what stable is. So definition. Okay. Where it becomes tricky. So Shelah has this thing for naming properties such that the negation of the property is the good thing. So is the interesting thing. So not stable is easier to define than stable in some sense. It's not stable if it has an inner order. And it doesn't just mean that you have a member of the class of inner orders inside, it means you can define it somehow. So by E, I will give a non-trivial example. There is a formula, a thing like the axiom of the prime form. E, x, y, and this means a sequence, so it's actually allowing many variables. And the member of the class M. And a bunch of sequences in M. I will give an example, because otherwise it's impossible. So that the formula defines an ordering on this sequence. So P of AI AJ holds if and only if I is less than J. So phi defines when AI is less than AJ. So example, so let's say K is less in orders, then you know PXY is just gonna be x0 is less than y0. So you just look at sequences of one element. And the order is just defined by the thing. And, you know, you can take m to be the rationals, for example, and ai to be I. And then, so this is just saying that the natural numbers are ordered by this. So this means that it is not stable. So it's bad, it's unstable, so it has many models. So we knew that already. But I should say, you know, there are non-trivial examples of that. So another example is the random graph. So you take a class, any graph that looks like a random graph. So what are the axioms for these things? You just say, so the elements of your class are going to be graphs, and there are going to be graphs that satisfy some homogeneity property, meaning that no matter what finitary pattern you have, it's going to be embedded in your graph. So there are going to be graphs that contain every possible finite graph, and everywhere. So the axiom is going to say when you have, so in your axioms you're just allowed to say that the vertices x and y are adjacent, and we write this by x equal, and the axiom will say every finite subset I'll add one axiom. So I'm not quantifying over sets in my axioms. I'm allowed countably many axioms. There are countably many sets like this. So I add one axiom, so I fix S, and I will say that no matter what vertices I choose, there is a y that's connected to x0, x and minus 1 exactly like s specified. So I have xi connected to y for every I in s, and xi not connected to y for every I not in s. So it's saying, you know, I have this bunch of xi's in my graph. And I want to say, oh, there is an element that's connected to x0 and x1, but dot x2. And for every possible pattern like this, there's an element. So any model of this theory is going to be like a graph, by definition. So this is this, and this is the class I'm going to study. So it's a weird class, and you might think, you know, it's a bunch of graphs that just have this unordered edge relation. How could it have the order property? How could it be unstable? But it is. So this is where you're going to use that you're allowed to have sequences of several elements in your definition. You're going to take phi to be something with four variable, and it's going to say that x0 is adjacent to 1, 1. Okay, and now I'll just draw a picture to explain why this works. So let's say you're in a very random graph. How do you define an ordering with this formula? Well, okay, you find some quadruple of vertices. And so let's say this is going to be a 0 plus 1, 0 plus 1 in the initial thing. And I'm just going to say, specify there is an edge here, but no edge there. So according to this relation, x0, x1 is less than y0, y1. And it's a random graph, so I can continue searching for this pattern. Fine, look at some other square like this, and find the pattern. So I can find a subgraph that looks like this. And in this subgraph, well, I still have this relation, but also y1, y2 will be less than one, z2. But not the other way around. If you reverse, if you swap these two things, you can check that because there's no edge here, things are not going to work out. So it's possible to define an order even in a random graph, provided you allow multiple sequences. You can, so it's necessary to allow multiple elements. Okay, so I hope it wasn't too much. So yeah, I just find this result very strong and interesting.
In classifying all these spectrum functions that you're talking about, what's the n square? I was just curious about what kind of property, what kind of dividing lines that are used to get the exact classification in the end.
Oh, well, actually you don't need that much more. So once you have all those five dividing lines, you can develop a lot of, already that if you are on the bad side of any of these dividing lines, you have many models, and so the function is monotonic, and you know the function. Exactly, it's just 2 to lambda. But if you have all those properties, you have the decomposition theorem, everything is so nice, you can develop a lot of theory. You don't have to define any other dividing line, you just have to analyze the examples carefully. So there's nothing more to do, you just have to do the tedious work of writing everything. So, I mean, I'm kind of lowering the work, but Shelah did most of the work already. You just have to analyze it. You know, it's a hard 100 pages paper, but it's not, there's no dividing lines involved, not in a strong way.
Okay, that's Sebastien.